So good afternoon, everyone. I'm Gilles Forestay. I'm working at EPFL, same group as Massimiliano. So introduce the group, but I will go a little bit more into details because I think it's important. So CITAS is the HPC group at EPFL. So we are dealing with HPC operations on a daily basis. We have several clusters, and they are around 300 and 400 petaflops, teraflops. Sorry. So we do normal operation, and also we do user support. So training courses, and in particular, I'm working on the parallelization and optimization, so on the not performance. But I will talk today about how we actually introduced big data into our HPC clusters. So obviously, up until very recently, we didn't really felt the need to put big data into our clusters, but obviously, so big data is the demand is increasing, and we had a look at how to actually include the frameworks into our clusters, because those are HPC clusters, and they support a fast network and high flop CPUs. So why not? Why not put the big data? But there were things that we were not prepared to do. So for example, we were not really ready to use Hadoop and HDFS and S3. Because we use a GPS face on a daily basis, and it's extremely fast, and we are very happy with it. So, that's where we drew the line. Also, we didn't really want to provide a framework without a project based on this, because we really wanted to have vertical solutions before proposing horizontal solutions, so that we wouldn't dig a nice hole into the wrong field. And that's what happened. I mean, 6 months ago, we were contacted by the Chair of Innovation and Intellectual Property, led by Professor Dora Senfos. And he provided a very good use case in order to develop this framework. So we took this opportunity to actually work on the TCO comparison between on-premise and public cloud providers. This is something that a lot of people at EPFL are asking. So, is it worth moving the data around to where the compute is, or is it better to actually move the compute where the data where the compute is? And this is actually something that is driving us a lot, because you will see that in this project we are actually trying to understand this because of the volume of data we are dealing with. Okay, so I will introduce the project we are actually working on. So this project is actually trying to trace innovation in the marketplace. Okay, so the basic idea is that the IIPP people would like to understand what is the impact of science and innovation in everyday life. Okay, so this means that they want to see what is the place that this innovation is taking in everyday's objects like a computer, and this is quite important, because they are trying to develop this economics of innovation, and they are trying to build a large-scale database that is associating an object with the patents it's composed of. Okay, so you get an object, whatever, laptop, anything you have, and you would like to know what is the list of patents that are associated with this in order to understand how innovation research and is impacting our life. And so up until very recently, it was actually very difficult to find this information, but now, recently in the US, there is something that is called virtual patenting, and it's because there was a law passed in the US recently, so this is this law, that is saying that if companies want to have, so have legal actions against, for patent infringement and that kind of things, they have to publish their patents on a web page. Okay, so they have to provide the list of their products and the patents that they have for this object. And this is creating the tool in order to build this database. So there's the law is right here. It's okay, legal words, but concretely, previously, this was the physical marketing example. So you had an object. So this one is aircraft seat, and you could find the patent on the the patent. It's 1950. Okay, so you have the name and everything. So title. So this was difficult actually to collect. It was okay. So you need to find the objects and the patents and everything. So now, it's actually much better, okay, so you don't see a lot of things, but you can find, for example, on the TiVo page, you can go and you see the products, the list of products, and all the patents that are associated with those objects. Okay, so this one is very nice because you really have the name and then the list. Other patents are bit more difficult to understand. So this one is IPC, and you have for example, you don't only have U.S. patents; you also have Singapore patents, which makes things a little bit more difficult to analyze. The first problem with this is that we need to access the raw data, meaning that we need to get the web pages where the patents are. Okay, and the second one is that the representation, so the law, the US law does not impose a format, okay, in the web page. So the representation of the data is extremely idiosyncratic. So this means that you have unstructured data that you need to deal with, and it's creating a lot of false positives too. So for example, this is what's called HVPM, so homepage virtual patent marking, and here you don't see it a lot so very well, but you have a patent number that is actually associated not to a product but to a web page. Okay, so this confuses even more the search of what we are looking for. Also, as you saw in the previous slide, so this, for example, it's difficult to distinguish between a U.S. patent or even a product. So this could be considered, if you have a code that is looking for patent numbers, this could be considered as a product. Okay, so it's actually very difficult to discriminate the pages. First problem is getting the data, and this one is really, really a huge problem because you have to actually crawl what is called web crawling, so you have to extract the web pages all over internet. And so this is done by, that's more or less the gist of how you do it. You start with web pages and you follow the links. Okay, and then you download everything you see, not the images but the HTML pages, and you store them somewhere. Okay, so you have a database. So this is actually very important for the private sector and academic research. Obviously, for the private sector, Google, Yahoo, Bing, they're all crawling the web all the time. That's how they create their database. On the academic side, It's an important source of data. For information retrieval research, and it's actually the base source of information for this nascent field of web science and computational social sciences. The problem is that crawling the web, so it's non-trivial because you have to have a very performant tool in order to do that, and also sometimes it's dangerous because the bandwidth required is huge, and you can take down web pages, sites, even routers if a lot of people are actually crawling the web at the same time. So there's quite a lot of literature about that and how to actually avoid robots and that kind of thing. Some web pages, actually, they forbid completely the web crawling, and so they shut down the operation. So, yeah, that's it's a dangerous task, but OK. So the problem with web crawling, when we actually can do it, is that nobody knows what's the total size of the internet. So clear web, dark web, so nobody knows. Okay, so we have an estimation. So that's the largest. So archive.org. So that's the largest repository of the internet, and it's around 200 terabytes. The problem is that so you have an API in order to query information, but you cannot download actually the data sets. Okay, so either you compute where the data is, or you do something else. And we are using Common Crawl because it's open data. The problem is that it's only 22 terabytes of data. You can download it directly. So this is actually the web page and all the. So every month they come up with a new data set. So the latest one is March. Maybe there's a new one, and each is around 20 to 30. I think the latest ones are 50 terabytes because they included the. So Amazon give them some. Links from Alexa, the Alexa web database. Yes. They try to increment, but it's not clear. Also, what they get. So there's. So they said that it's around 50% new at each iteration, but it's not really. There's no real statistics on this. So they try to put more and more. Pages and in order but that's it's difficult to know. So Common Crawl. So we got a few. So they told us what they are using, and so they are running on Amazon. AWS. Okay, so it's free for them because Amazon is helping them, and one crawl, okay, takes around 2 weeks to produce on I think it's 50 or 60 instances. That's roughly 200 cores, I think. So pre-processing, fetching the data, and post-processing takes around 2 weeks to produce. They give you 30 terabytes of data roughly, but in reality they download hundreds of terabytes of data, and then they post-process it, and in the end you get the 50 terabytes. So for us, yeah. So that's where it was is getting interesting. So it took us 20 days to download the 30 terabytes. It was 25 terabytes of data. It took 20 days because the bandwidth is limited by the Amazon website. So they said no more than 30 megabytes per second. So 20 days latency in order to get the data before we actually start the computation. Okay, then after we got the data, it took only a few days in order to analyze the data with Spark.
So
No, because I tried on Grena, same as, actually it was slower than at EPFL. No, because it's a bucket, I think. So it's a database somewhere. It's a file system. I don't know if you can actually. Yeah. No, but okay, maybe we can. But okay, so it's still a lot of time in order to get the data. Okay. So in terms of TCO, I mean this is a huge problem because 20 days of data transfer and then only a few days in order to compute. Okay, we are not even sure that this is it's worth it. Okay, so either we can reuse the data, so we get everything and people can take advantage of it, but different people, or I mean maybe we can make the data closer. I think switch as a mirror of this, but it's not sure, so it could be faster. Okay, we are in contact with them. We are trying to understand. Okay, so if you understand French, there was a very nice broadcast on the French radio, and they talked about the, I don't know if you heard of this, but it's called the Venice Time Machine. It's a project of EPFL trying to create a virtual time machine in order to understand how Venice was 5 years ago, 10 years ago, 20 years ago, and there was a small discussion of so for example the French National Library, they are doing exactly the same. They are trying to archive the French web. Okay, they started this 15 years ago, I think, or 20 years ago, and at this time, they contacted already the archive.org people, and they asked them to transfer data overseas through the cables, and they realized that it was way too much. So actually, archive.org shipped the racks with the disk on the boat overseas, and the conclusion is that they. So everybody is saying that the web is immaterial, but actually it's very, very material. You have to put it somewhere, and it's very difficult to move. Okay, so this is the actual part that we've been using in order to have a Spark running on our cluster. So as I said before, we didn't really want to use Hadoop and HDFS and that kind of things because the area is one is too far. Okay, we use GPFS. We want to stick with this. And Spark is actually very nice because it's a lightweight. It's really lightweight compared to Hadoop. And you don't really need to use HDFS. I mean, you provide a POSIX path, and it will work. It's relatively consistent with our resource scheduler, which is Slurm. So they really we didn't have to change a lot of things in order to have a Spark running on our cluster. The only thing is that you need to differentiate, so you have the driver and you have the worker, so when you launch Slurm allocation, you need to have one node taking care of all the work, and then master and worker. So that was the only difference. The standalone cluster mode is providing all those scripts that are very nice. I mean, you just need to use those when you launch your Spark allocation. Is working out of the box. Those are the scripts that I wrote in order to wrap Slurm around Spark. So that's so we have two main scripts: so start and stop Spark, and it's. So this one is executing another script that's actually differentiating the master and the workers, because you need to pass those to your Spark code. And so that's the stop. Spark is the same. So you see there's a difference. And the execute is something like this. So you this is actually making the link between Slurm and Spark. Okay, so and then it's calling itself in order to differentiate itself. And if you're the first node in the allocation, you'll be master, and then otherwise you'll be slave. Okay, an example of this. So this is a very simple Spark. So it's PySpark. I used this to compute the diffusion pattern over a grid, a structured grid. Okay, it's extremely easy. You can find this on the web. And so this is what it looks like. So we load the module. We start Spark. Then so this little script will give you the address of master. Then you pass this address to Spark. So Spark submit, diffusion. You stop. That's it. And that's the execution. You see a pattern. Okay. So that's the result. In terms of strong scaling, so as you can see, so that's actually the number of workers, and that's the number of segments. So the data we get from command crawl, they come in segments. Okay, so each segment is around I don't know, maybe 20 gigabytes of data. And so we performed a scalability analysis over the network, GPFS, so starting from one segment to half a segment, and this is actually the estimated time to solution for the full 100 segments. Okay, and we can see that it's scaling extremely well. Okay, so the network is doing its job. So that's very good. So you can see also that if you use a 16, so I did 32 and 64, but it consumed a lot of resources. So if you use 16 nodes, so 16 workers plus one node as a master, it's a little less than 2 days in order to parse the 25 terabytes of data, which is quite good. So based on the August command crawl, after processing the data, we got 70 million candidate pattern numbers, and among those you get 5.5 million unique candidate pattern numbers, and they come from 2.9 million candidates VPN pages, so big companies, and 36,500 companies or domain. So this is actually the code is performing quite well, and we were able to build a very nice database out of this. The only problem is that the code we have, so it's a regular expression trying to match the pattern of the data as well, the web pages I showed you, it's still producing a lot of false positives, which is a problem. Okay, so that's where we are right now. We are trying to understand how to fine-tune the algorithm. So, for example, we are trying to use deep learning in order to recognize the product names and the patents associated with this product. So, as you saw, this page, for example, is a problem because we cannot really have an automatic way to differentiate this between. So Singapore could be anything, could be an object, it could be anything. So this is that's a problem. Training, so having a deep learning inference. So we are using Alchemy right now. It's still difficult to do that. I mean, we are trying to find a way. There are several solutions. So, for example, there's a page. So, there's a Google page which is called the patent. So, Google patent. You can go there. You can type the patent, and it will show you everything that is related to this patent. So, there could be a way to actually understand if this is a false positive or not. But It's a hard problem for deep learning, apparently. So if you have some kind of solution, I'll take it. The other thing we are working on is that we're trying to minimize the data stored on our disks before we launch the analysis. And this can be done by using what is called a focused web crawler. Those focused web crawlers, so focused web crawlers are actually, so they are designed to look for a specific information. So for example, the one we are using is called a storm crawler. Okay, and this one is designed to look for web pages that contain news. Right? So, but it's possible to modify it to get whatever you want. So we are developing this this crawler in order to download only what we are looking for. It doesn't have to be extremely precise because after that we are going to still run the analysis, but that's a good way to reduce the footprint of what we have. So actually move the data closer to compute. It's early development. This one is based on external resources, so Elasticsearch and Kibana and Tika. It's very nice. So actually, we implemented it on a laptop. So we installed it on a laptop, and we ran it on so very quickly for in order to test the limitations. And so laptop with a virtual machine. So the seeds we used, it was only 3 entries and limited to 30 minutes, and we got 300 kilobytes of data zipped, so in a WARC format, the same as the command crawl is using. And then it took 7 seconds to parse and to come up with those numbers. The problem is that during those 30 minutes, a huge amount of data was already transferred through the network. So it's going in the right direction, but it's okay. It's still a lot of resources needed. Another thing we are trying to understand is to use actually the GPFS connectors. So we are going to receive a new cluster from Huawei, and the storage is very, very nice, very fast, and we'd like to take advantage of this by actually plugging those connectors in order to accelerate everything, okay? It's extremely easy to implement. IBM is providing everything we need to do it. Probably it's going to improve the I/O bandwidth. It's not completely clear if it's really needed because, okay, so computation is already very fast. So we'll see, that's ongoing. Right, so the conclusions. So for us, it was extremely easy to install Spark and everything that's needed on our cluster. Spark is really becoming platform agnostic, so it's very easy to use. You just download the distribution, you put it somewhere, you export the path, and that's it, it's working, it's very nice. It was also extremely easy to have the communications with the resource manager, which is Slurm in our case. And the parallel shared file systems are working very well. Now we are trying to go into containers, and so we are looking to a Shifter and Singularity, especially for reproducibility, because we would like to ship this contained somewhere so that we don't, I mean, yeah. It's still unclear for us what is the best place to compute. If those users are the only one using the data and the web crawl, it's probably better if they run directly on Amazon. But okay, we are trying to understand if this is really true, and we are trying to get more users to use this because having a repository of the internet is becoming more and more important for people, in particular in research. So in order to determine this, we are working on the TCO. That's our metric. I'm not sure it's the right one, but okay. So we have to start somewhere. And so more specifically, we are looking into specific solutions to reduce the stored data footprint, which could be one solution, and do a deep learning in order to detect pattern pages. But it's, apparently it's a very hard problem. And so we'll get a new hardware, so new cluster, and it has a local SSDs, and so it should be more data friendly, so everything will be accelerated. Okay, so thank you very much.